talking about Abraham, I've been thinking what new series to start. And I was having a hard time thinking of what I should do next. There's lots of different ideas I have on what kind of things to preach about, and it took me quite a while until finally yesterday I came to the point that I want to start speaking about. And we will focus on this passage for a little while. The next couple of Sundays will be related with 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 2 through 10. We only have, really, four weeks left before the retreat. Well, great, 4 weeks left before we have the retreat. So I hope you are praying for the retreat, and I hope that you're getting your hearts ready for it. Sometimes it's easy to go along and do all the planning and forget about the importance of why we're having the retreat, to think about Jesus and to learn from him. So I want to tell you something about myself here a little bit. I have been having chest pains for quite a while, and 4 years ago I went to the doctor and it felt kind of strange. So he said everything was fine, you know, healthy and good. And I went and I did the stress test, you know, where you run on the machine, and everything looked fine through that test. But every now and then I have this, or I'll wake up and at night I'm about to sleep and I just feel this like squeezing pain in my chest. You know, I often think that, you know, it'll be a heart attack or something. I'm very worried about that. And that occurs quite often, but it seems, you know, if it comes that often, it can be a heart attack, you know. Anyway, so I went to the doctor again and he said maybe it was stress. And I thought, well, what am I stressed about? And that was all before I moved here. And I didn't think about it. And as time went on, after moving here, you know, once in a while, I had that pain again. Well, this past Thursday, I felt just very strange. You know, I felt almost like my body was going numb. I didn't really have pain necessarily, but just felt very odd and different. So I thought I should go into the hospital. And again, they did all the tests. Everything was fine. They took blood, did blood work. And they said, well, perhaps there's clot in your lungs. And so they checked for that. That had happened to my father before, so I know that could be a genetic problem. So they went ahead and did a CT scan, but nothing showed up, so it was good. And so again, the doctor said, well, it might be just stress. So that's a challenge for me to stay focused on God more. Even though I'm a pastor, I can still lose my focus on God and focus on the responsibilities and the planning aspects. So that was a conviction for me that even though while I'm busy and doing things for God, I need to remember to give them over to him and keep him as my focus. So please pray for me to not be stressed about the responsibilities that I have, but to keep God first and to rest in his strength. Anyway, so that's just a side note. But I don't know how you feel about the retreat, if you're stressed or if you're fine. I know that everything will come together and it will be okay. It's important for you to look in your own hearts and have your lives prepared. Not just being busy about the retreat, but remembering that it's important to think of Christ. And everyone, can you see me fine? I could sod. I could take a set off and put it in there. I know that some of you might miss out a little bit because you'll be busy doing other things. And maybe you'll have to miss out on a few sermons. But I want this to be in our minds, to be an example for other people. Not to do things just to be a leader. Whether you're a leader or not, that everyone would be an example to other people. We look at 1 Thessalonians, we'll give you some background. This was a letter written to the people who lived in the city of Thessalonica. This was a church, a very young church, and Paul had established it, and they quickly, or Paul had established it, and then he had to leave very soon after that, and so he wanted to make sure everything was okay at this church. And so Paul's assistant went and, you know, surveyed the church and made sure that they were doing fine. And he said, you know, this church has changed. They are doing wonderfully well. They are so focused on God. And so Paul, writing, said that this church became an example for other Christians in the area. That whereas before they had worshipped idols and been involved in all kinds of sin, they completely turned from that and focused on God. And this is for, become an example for other deaf around you and for hearing as well. So we're going to emphasize three things today: faith, love, and hope. And these are the three things that would cause us to be examples for other people. Since we give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing your work of faith, the labor of love, and patience, or we could change that word and say endurance, our endurance of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of our God and Father. Knowing, beloved brethren, your election by God. Election means those that have been chosen by God for salvation. And for our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and in much assurance, as you know what kind of men we were among you for your sake. And the "we" here is speaking of Paul and his assistants. That's what he means every time you see that "we." It says, and you became followers of us and of the Lord. You became followers of Paul. Was Paul being egotistical here and prideful? No, Paul was very humble. He said, you were following us because I follow Christ. Jesus is the example that I copy. And so as you see my life, you can copy me. And as you are copying me, you actually are following the Lord. So having received the word in much affliction, with joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became example to all in Macedonia, the KI, those are the countries in the area, so that you became example to all who believe. Verse 8. For from you the word of the Lord has sounded forth, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith toward God has gone out, so that we do not need to say anything. So they've already spread the gospel, and so Paul doesn't have to do much work. In verse 9, for they themselves declare concerning us what manner of entry we had to you, and how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God. You see this phrase here, turn to God. That again is the idea of repentance. You repented from idols, stopped worshiping them, or whatever religion you had been involved in before, and then they had turned to the living and true God. And to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. A little bit of a long section, and I'm not going to be preaching on all of it today, just focusing on verses 2 and 3, and then next Sunday, probably verses 4 through 6, and then the following Sunday, 7 through 10. There's too much information to cram it all into one sermon, so we're going to divide it up into a few sermons today. So this is part 1 of 3. Let's go ahead and pray. Father in heaven, I thank you for your word that you've given to us. And there's a question we had: does your word apply to today? Yes, it does. Your word is everlasting. It never fails. Thank you for preserving your word for the past 3,000 years that we still have it with us today. We have it in all sorts of different translations, but your word is there, and thank you for the wonderful word. Thank you that we can have confidence in your word, that we can know that it will be applicable to our lives today. Sometimes people will say that the culture was different back then from now, and so we can't use those same principles, but we know that we can, and I pray that you help us be challenged today to be an example to other people. Because of faith and love and hope that we have in us. Please help me to preach your words clearly, and that it would apply to everyone's lives here. And I pray that those listening would have their hearts open and be ready to accept any challenge, accept any change that you want us to make for you. In Jesus' name, amen. The title for the sermon today is going to be Common Experience. That will stay the title for the next few sermons as well. So in your qualities, you are to become an example of believers. Your qualities, your character, who you are, is to be an example. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 2 through 3, we'll look at that in a minute. Because we give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers. Verse 2. Paul often opened a letter with this phrase. In Ephesians, you'll find this phrase. In Colossians, in Philippians, in 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, really in nearly all of his letters, he says, I thank God for you, for those of you who are faithful. Paul is very positive. He finds something to commend them for. You know, Paul could say, this church has all sorts of problems, and he could just be negative and ream them out, but he doesn't. He always says, I'm praying for you. And so in that, we see an example by Paul that he's always thankful to God. He says, I always give thanks for you all. And I mention you in our prayers. Seems that Paul often prayed for other people, not praying for just himself. When we pray, we often pray for ourselves. But we need to remember to include others in our prayers. In verse 3, it says, remembering without ceasing your work of faith. That's one thing we're going to speak of today. Your labor of love and your patience or endurance of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. And then I will explain each one of these things a little bit more. There are three qualities here. Faith, love, and hope. So first we can see our works that will produce by faith. Good works can be things like going to church, telling the gospel to others, reading your Bible, and serving, like for the death retreat, you know, being an usher, helping people know where to go. Those are called works, the things that you do, the things of service you do. And why do you do those things? Because you already have faith. Your faith in God will affect the things that you do for God. If I don't have any faith in God, the good things that I do become worthless. In Isaiah, it says that all of your righteous works are as filthy rags because you don't have any faith. Once you have saving faith, that faith will help you grow and follow the Lord. Follow the Lord, and we follow him by faith, and that faith also helps us do things that are profitable, that are beneficial. In Ephesians chapter 2 verses 8 through 10, perhaps maybe none of you know this. Verse 8 says, for by grace you have been saved through, what is that there? Faith. I believe in faith that God has given me grace to be saved. And that not of yourselves. You've not been saved by your own doing. It is the gift of God. That means that your faith, those of you who believe, has been given to you as a gift. You believe because God gave you the ability to believe. He gave you faith to believe. Okay, does that make sense? By nature, you are sinners. And you cannot believe God by yourself. The Bible says that we are spiritually dead. We have no communion with God until at that moment when you understand the gospel and you believe in that, it says that God gives you faith. Faith is a gift of God in order to become saved. See, I explained this once before. I think, I'm trying to think of the right name. There was a man who invented the artificial heart, I think back in like the 1980s. And then, you know, you can also get a heart transplant. Which one would be better, an artificial heart or a heart transplant? A heart transplant is better than an artificial heart. Because it's quite as good as the real thing. Does anyone know when that was? I don't remember it. I was very small when this was big news. This was back in the 1980s. But when the first successful heart transplant was done, artificial heart transplant, they took from a person who died, they took took that person's heart, and they, you know, this heart would be dead, so to speak, because it was taken out of a dead body, and then it was put into this other person who needed a heart. And then the doctor, you know, starts up, charges it, and then the heart gets to beat. You know, they would shock the heart into beating, and it would get going once it was all hooked up into the new body. That's an amazing thing. And we can use that as an example for our spiritual lives. We have no heart. We are dead. And God has to give us a new heart. And he's the one who charges it up, who shocks it into beating. And that's how, in a comparison, God gives us our faith. Remember, God made Adam, made him from the ground, from dirt. And then what did God do next after he shaped him and formed him? Adam was dead. He wasn't alive yet. And God breathed into his nostrils and gave him the breath of life so that now he was a living soul. And then God could communicate and have a relationship with Adam. Those of us who may be alive, we might be living, but we don't have any spiritual life until God gives us a new heart. And that's what this is speaking of in Ephesians. That God is the one who gives me the grace, the faith, to be saved. And then once we believe, the Holy Spirit comes into us and gives us new spiritual life. And gets our spiritual heart beating. So those of you who are saved, who have this new heart, this new life, you are blessed. Those who don't are lost. They are in darkness. You can believe because God is God. He gives you that faith. Verse 9 says, not of works. Faith doesn't come by me doing things to gain faith. If I try to work it out and do it on my own, what would happen? You could boast about it. God does not want us to be boastful. If I wasn't saved through faith, let's say I could be saved by going to church, very faithful, and attending church. And when I died, God would say, Brian, why should I let you into heaven? You could say, oh, well, because I went to church every single opportunity I had. I never missed a Sunday. Would God be so impressed with that he'd let me into heaven? No. He can't shock God at the good things that we do. God hates pride, it says in the scriptures. And by trying to do good things to earn our way into heaven, God's going to that's not how it works. But those who are saved through faith in Jesus Christ, when we get to heaven, God can say, why should I let you into my heaven? And we can say, because I have believed in your Son and that he took the penalty for my sin. And God's going to say, sure, come on in, welcome home. We can boast in Christ. He's the one that did it for us, but in myself, in my own works, in my own attempts, we cannot boast in that. This word blessed means if not. It says, not of works, so that no one should boast. And it seems to be a little bit ironic here. It says, I thought you can't be saved by doing good. Well, hold on a minute, and we'll see. We are saved through faith alone. God gives us saving faith. I cannot do it of myself. And then look at what verse 10 it says. It says, for we are his workmanship. What does that mean? In past days, there was a job of blacksmith. That would be a person who was often responsible for designing swords, or they would design horseshoes. They did metalworks. But they could design, let's say, a sword craft, they're beautiful, they could put their name to it or their seal on it. And then they would know who made that sword or who made that item that they were using. They knew that it belonged to this certain blacksmith. It was his design. Or on TV, sometimes there used to be a show, I don't know if it's still on, there used to be a show, this man with golden curly poofy hair, he would draw, and he'd show you how to draw different things on TV, and he would always say his name to it. And so that you would know that it was his work. For those of you who are saved, you are Christ's, you are God's work. I like to say you have God's stamp or his signature on you because of the Holy Spirit is in you. And so you ought to show and to demonstrate that he made you. You were created by him. So God designed you. You are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for the purpose of good works. Before you were saved, God did not design you for doing good works. But now that you are saved, and God has given you a new heart, now you are enabled to do good works for him, for God. And that is something that God planned beforehand, that we should walk in them, in the good works. That God had a plan for your life to do good things for him. He had that planned already. And his intention is that once you are saved, that you are to do good works for God. Not before you're saved, but after you're saved. Then you can do things for him. If any of you haven't been baptized, that's a good work that is missing. God intends for everyone who is saved to become baptized to show that you are willing to follow Christ. That's a good work that you can do. If you haven't explained the gospel to anybody else, you're missing out on a good work. You say, well, I don't know what to say, and so I'm quiet about it. Well, you're missing out on opportunities. Maybe you are convicted that you need to read the Bible more. You say, well, but I'm busy, and I don't have time for it. Well, then you're missing out on a good work that God has intended for you to do.
The other one.
It's a little bit long, so I'll just condense it here a little bit for you. You can read it, and then I'll just from just these verses. This is, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled or already cleansed from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Verse 23, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering or doubting, for he who promised is faithful. Verse 24, let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. You have to have faith before you can have good works. Do you see that progression there? There's faith, then there's hope, and then comes good works. And an example of good works is not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. That means that we come together here today to worship God. And if I say, oh, I'm not going to come to church, then you're missing an opportunity to do good works. When you come to church, it's for the purpose of encouraging other people and helping them draw near to God. When you come to church and if you sit by yourself and don't encourage anyone else, that's not a good work. That's being selfish. But to come together and encourage each other in Christ, that's the purpose of church. To learn about God, yes, so that I can serve others. So you have works that were produced by your faith, and secondly, your hard work that was done from love for God and others. So we've talked about faith. Secondly, the second characteristic we see is love. It's interesting, we have these words here, work of faith and labor of love. Work and labor, aren't they a little bit similar? Labor does sort of mean work, but it's interesting in the Bible here, these words are used a little bit differently. Work means the things that you do. Labor here implies with sweat, with toil, with hard effort. Today, let's think of farming. Okay? Does farming take a lot of work and effort today? Not really. Sit in the tractor and drive, but it used to take much effort. There was a lot of sweat involved, plowing the fields and getting it straight, getting it ready to plow. I have a friend in Idaho who has his tractor in coordination with GPS, and so he just sits and all he has to do is, at the turn, he just has to steer the tractor into a right line, and then if you know the tractor gets out of line, it'll beep or something, and so he can correct it and make it go in a straight line. And you know, so he just gets to sit in his tractor and text away, or you know, look at the most painted or whatever, and then he just turns the tractor to go in the right direction at the end of the row and turn it around, and then it goes back. And he's got air conditioning in there, nice fans in the cab, and the machine just kind of done it for him. Probably someday our cars will be the same. You can sit in your car and your car will drive for you. You just sit there. But, you know, today farming is easy. So we don't really understand this labor concept. But love involves sweat and toil and hard work. Lots of effort. It's not always easy to love others. The Bible definition of love, remember I said that there are four different types of loves, four Greek words for love. There's agape, which is not thinking of yourself, but thinking only of other people, thinking of the best for others. There's phileo, which is friendship love, or brotherly love. Philadelphia, the city Philadelphia, comes from that word, phileo, and it's supposed to mean city of brotherly love, which I've heard it doesn't live up to that name at all. Then there's eros, which is a sexual love. Not necessarily the bad way. It can be positive. It can be negative as well. But those two things are opposite, actually. Agape and eros are on opposite ends of the scale. Agape thinks only of the good for others. Eros is usually in more of a negative way of more fulfilling your own lustful desires. You know, sometimes that's okay, but it's often negative. It can be a very selfish love. But agape puts yourself aside and thinks only for the good of other people. And a proof of agape love is here in John 3:16. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son," that's Jesus. And this word love here is agape. For God so loved the world that he was not selfish for his Son, Jesus. That he did not keep him in heaven. But he so much loved the world, he gave up himself and he sent his Son into the world so that people can go to heaven and have everlasting life. Let's look at another example. Romans 5:8. But God demonstrates. Demonstrate means to show with action or to prove. You know, I don't know if it's quite as common today, but there used to be salesmen who would go door to door and they would demonstrate their product. You know, maybe it would be insurance or vacuums or whatever. You know, people say no solicitors, you know, and so the salesmen can't come as freely anymore as they used to. They would come and they would show your product. Oh, I have an example. ShamWow, you know the commercial? I don't know if you like that commercial or not. The ShamWow commercial, have you ever seen that on TV? This guy, he's really skinny, and he's got this earpiece, and he talks, and he's got this yellow towel, and you know, he pours a big thing of pop into a bowl, and the ShamWow soaks it all up. And he rolls it up, twists it out, and all the pop streams out of it. You know, I gotta tell you, it really does that. The commercial isn't to lie. I'm gonna give him a little advertisement right here for ShamWow. I'm telling you, I've got it, and it works. It's really great. That's not my point. But anyway, I'm not going to encourage you to buy ShamWow, but I'm just saying how that commercial, they demonstrate it to show what it does. That's demonstration. We went, you know, honestly, I doubted the TV commercial. I wanted to see it in real life. But at Walmart down here a couple years ago, I got to see that. They had a booth, and they convinced me, you know, we got, what was it? Some of the orange squares and some of the blue squares. I only had $10 and they wanted 20 and another person was there. And so we both chipped in 10 bucks and split our purchase in half. But we could see it in real life. We could see the proof of what they were trying to sell. And so the same way God demonstrates, he proved it. He showed it with action by sending the Son to die for us. That is proof of his love. That's proof of agape love. Mm-hmm. 1 John 4:7-9 talks about how God loved people. And then if we are saved or born of God, then that means his character should be in us, and his love for people means we have to have love for other people. And so now we come to verse 11. It says, "Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to what? Love one another." These two words here are the same. They are both agape. God proved his love with action. So that gives me no right to dislike James here, or say I'm not going to have a relationship with him and be nice to him because I don't like him. But I can't do that. Because if you don't have love for your brothers in Christ, then very strong statement. Hatred, dislike for one another is not right. Not to be willing to serve other people. Like, thank God for the band ministry. I'm responsible for planning the schedule for that, for those who go and pick up people from Inspiration Ministries. We have a lot of people there in wheelchairs and things like that. But there's one man who is just so incredibly willing to help out. You know, sometimes the people don't always smell feel great because of, you know, physical problems that they have or whatever. But that man is always willing to help and willing to work with them. Are we willing to work in the nursery? Just one example. Are we willing to work in the nursery? The kids just bother me and, you know, they consume my attention and are willing to change diapers. You know, the cute little babies aren't too bad sometimes, I think, in my experience anyway. But once they get older, oh, they're pretty nasty. Those kids that eat solid food, are we willing to do that? Are we willing to work there? Showing love, having agape love. Proves that you're willing to help and serve others. If someone spills something, you get frustrated and mad, and or are you willing to go and clean it up and help out? Those are just examples of serving other people. Are you willing to be a servant? But remember, we'll be back up in a little bit. This is your hard work. And you love other people. You're not thinking of yourself. You're thinking of others, and that is not easy. Honestly, we are selfish. People in general are selfish. As in fact, the Bible says that you are selfish people. I'm not trying to call you names or anything, but that's the fact. We're selfish. Really, most of our daily lives are lived for ourselves, to do things for ourselves. We need to be willing to change that a little bit more. You know, I'm saying this not that I am speaking out against any particular person or cause, but I know myself and I am selfish. If you see something in your life that is a symptom of selfishness, try to change that. One example is your time. Are you willing to sacrifice your time for other people? We often get so picky about our time and how we use it. How about your money? Oh, we are selfish and tightwads when it comes to money. Somebody helped you for money. Maybe you can't just, you know, write a blank check to the person. You can't do that. I'm pretty sure none of you have that much money. But some of you have a little bit that you can offer to help to others. Don't be selfish. Have a giving heart. There are so many ways that you can show love for other people. We need to stop thinking of ourselves first. For husbands and wives, here's a really simple example. The husbands and wives often have two TVs because they can't get along, you know, and choose what they want to watch, so they just get two TVs. Love means I'm willing to give up what I want to watch for someone else. The husband says, oh, wife, you get to watch all the time, and I'm always giving you what you want to watch. Does that mean maybe the wife got to give up something for her husband once in a while? You know, sometimes if you have an indecisive battle, that would be a good thing. It shows that you're considering the other person more. You can't decide what to watch because you want the other person to pick what they're going to watch. All right, and then the third point. Your endurance because of your hope in Christ Jesus. Your works that were produced by your faith, your hard work that was done from love for God and others, your endurance because of your hope in Christ Jesus. The key in here is hope. This word appears many times in the scripture, and it is never in the context of meaning of hope when we say, oh, I hope something happens. Hope means a constant knowledge that something is going to happen. It is not, oh, I hope that this will happen. I hope that God will work this out. But hope here means that I have confidence that something is going to occur. So you can endure because you have hope or confidence in Christ Jesus. How many of you have been watching the Olympics? I haven't seen all of them, but some I've gotten to watch. Lindsay Vonn, I got to see her, how she had her, she had an injured knee, but she continued on because she had confidence in herself. She had endurance. She knew she could do it. And then she ended up getting a medal. I think she won a gold and a silver. Anyway, that's just a comparison. Not to be confident in herself, no, but to be confident in Christ, to know that when I die, I am going to be on my way to heaven. I can be confident in that fact. And therefore, I can endure. I can be patient in the school class. I was teaching about Peter. And what kind of death did he experience? He was crucified upside down. He was willing to face that because of his confidence in Christ. Andrew was crucified on an X-shaped cross. James, I talked about this morning, he was killed. He was killed by the sword. All the apostles except for John were martyred. Because they, oh, I don't want that. None of the apostles said, I can't go through that. No, all of them were willing to die for Christ because they had confidence in Christ. They were able to endure because of their hope, their confidence in Christ. So you see, work and love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the key, that we are confident in Him. We know that He has saved us. And that when I die, all my problems, trouble will be gone, and I know that I will be like Him. That is our hope. That is the thing we ought to look forward to with confidence. And then when Christ sees us, He can commend us that we are doing things in the sight of our God and Father. This is at the end of the passage that we'll be looking at in verse 10. It says, and to wait for His Son from heaven. Those of us who are saved, we are watching and waiting for Jesus to come. Some of us might die before He comes again now, okay? Those of us who will be here when Jesus comes and that picks us up, that's fine too. But we are to wait for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead. Even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. The Bible clearly says that God does have wrath against sin. God has wrath against those who refuse to believe the gospel. And the book of Revelation explains what is going to occur in the future, what's going to occur to those who do not believe in Jesus. And those who die without Christ, God's wrath is on them. We have hope. Because Jesus has saved us from that. You won't experience God's wrath because you are saved. What a blessing. What a wonderful thing that we have confidence in God, that we can trust Him, that no matter what happens, you know that you have a relationship with God. Maybe sometimes you think, oh, my life is a mess. It's worthless. It's not worth living anymore. Or people are unfriendly to me. Or all those things should not cause us to lose hope. We can have confidence that Christ saved us. We can know that He will be there to help us. Your heart times, in comparison to the people in Thessalonica, your heart times are nothing compared to them. Remember, Paul was kicked out of that city because people didn't like what he preached. And the people who were in Thessalonica, they were put into prison. They were killed. They were driven from the city, and yet they still continued in their relationship with God because they had the confidence in Christ. They knew that He was their Savior. Yeah, I think Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know that when he is revealed, or when we see him, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And I will become like him. And everyone who has this hope, or the hope of becoming like him, purifies himself. Because he is pure. Right now, I don't know exactly how my body is going to be when I die, what I'm going to become, but I do know that when Jesus comes, when he appears, and I see him face to face, I will be like him. Christ's resurrected body was able to appear in the midst of a locked room. Remember, the disciples were meeting together in despair and discouragement, and Christ showed up in the room, and then he ate fish and bread. He has a real body because he was able to eat, but he just appeared there. How amazing. So most likely, when this says we will be like him, we're probably going to be like that, you know? Or we ought to now be purifying ourselves. Christ has no sin. He is sinless. I still have sin. My body still has struggles and fleshly desires and sin habits, but I know that when I see him, I will be like him. And my sin will be completely gone. My struggles and sin habits. Maybe you have something that is really getting you down, some sinful habit. Keep that in mind, that someday when you see him, you will be like him. That you will be pure. So now work on being pure, so that you can see him and be completely pure in the future. This is a challenge to become an example of the qualities of your life in the works that you do because of your faith, because of the labor of love for God and for others. And more endurance, even if sometimes you feel exhausted.